used to have. Ah, ok, recording, ok. So in fact, we realize that in many contexts, it's important to have real-time constraints in systems. Like I listed here a couple of network protocols, for instance, where real-time plays a role, and probabilities are also useful in those protocols. And we know many kind of models for those. I will try to move that. Sorry, there's a bar here in the middle. Okay, so there are many models in the literature that have this kind of features. Like the simplest one, I would say, are the continuous time Markov chains, but you have many other ones like generalized Markov processes, stochastic time automata, and even other systems like the Markov continuous space Markov processes. And in fact, this approach will apply to classes of this kind of models. Okay, so I want to give an example. This is a GSMP. So GSMP is for generalized semi-Markov process. So it doesn't really matter what this means in general, but you have a finite state system where some machines can be up or down. So M1 and M2 can be up or down. And there can be some events happening, like a crash. So the machine may crash, and the machine needs to be rebooted afterwards. And this event happens with some probability distribution on delays. So for instance, we assume in this example that crash event follows some exponential distribution. That means that the way it will occur follows this distribution. So it's likely to happen quite soon, but it may happen a bit later. And in this example, I assume that the reboot event is something that follows a bounded uniform distribution. This is completely arbitrary, and this will apply to many other examples. So what does that mean? That means that if we are in some state, so I took this top state in this machine, in this finite state machine, and how does this model work? In fact, the two events that can happen are reboot one and crash two from this state. So we can see if crash one applies, then we go to this state. If reboot two applies, then we go back to this state. And these events are sampled according to their distribution. And then when you have sampled this event, you apply a race condition to know whether crash one will happen first or reboot will happen first. In that case, we go to the next state of the system, and so on and so forth. From this state, we can see that crash two has to be resampled. So as this is an exponential distribution, then it's you can resample it as if it was not activated before. And crash one has to be sampled also here, because now it's a new event that is available. And we continue that way, and we can navigate in this graph. You can see that, in fact, this defines some kind of infinite state system, because the delays, the timing of the different events have to appear in the configuration. So, in fact, this generates an infinite, non-denumerable stochastic transition system. I will be a bit more formal a bit later. But we can see that this is quite complex system that we can generate using this simple example. And in fact, the challenges of real-time stochastic system are of the following. So you have an intricate combination between time and probabilities. And this kind of system generates uncountable state space, uncountable branching because of time. And we have continuous probability distributions. So in the previous example, we had exponential distribution and uniform distribution, but you can assume many other kinds of distribution over the delays. And what are our objectives in this context? We want to achieve some kind of model checking, which can be qualitative in the sense, can we decide whether a property holds almost surely, or more quantitative problem, which is to compute a probability that some property holds, or to compute an approximation of this quantity, of this probability. Okay, so I will start Then with simpler systems, which are not continuous time systems, but discrete time systems, and we, I will start with Markov chains, which are maybe models that you know better. So discrete time Markov chain, so it will be DTMC for short, is it's a denumerable state space with distribution between the states. So I give an example, it's easier. So you have this example here, so you have a finite number of states, and then you have a distribution with finite support, saying that from S0, for instance, you can go to S1 or to S3, and each of one will occur with probability 1/2. And you have finite state space, which means that this is a finite Markov chain. And you have also denumerable Markov chains where the state, you have the same, so the support of distribution is finite, or it can be denumerable if you wish, but the state space is assumed to be denumerable. So for instance, this is a random walk, with one dimension, so you can go to the left or to the right with some probability. Okay. On what is our aim? So I will focus in this in many parts of this talk on reachability property, which is I want to compute the probability of reaching some target. So here it's this happy guy that I want to reach. But in fact, this applies in the context of Markov chains. This applies also to more complex omega regular properties, because in fact, often this, the probability of omega regular properties amounts to finding the reachability, the value of the reachability property. For instance, in finite Markov chains, this amounts to finding BSCC, so bottom strongly connected component of a Markov chain, and to check reachability property of these BSCCs. I will not get into this detail here. I will mostly focus on reachability properties. I want to compute that the probability of some property in some stochastic model, which is in this part denumerable Markov chains. So we know that we can characterize somehow the probability of reaching a state, which is if I'm at this state, then the probability is one, of course. If I can no more reach this state, then the probability is zero. Otherwise, I have some linear combination with the successor. So I know that the probability of reaching the target from S is the probability to go to some state T and then to reach the target. So T different from the happy guy. And we know that the least fixed point of this kind of equation characterizes the probability of reaching a state. Okay, so that's something very useful, but it's only useful for finite Markov chains, in the sense that then it amounts to solving a system of linear equations, and we can do it for finite Markov chains, which are not too big. But what happens if we want to handle infinite Markov chains? Because then we go to infinite continuous Markov chains. So we need to at least know how we should proceed with denumerable Markov chains. So in general, exact solutions do not exist, or we cannot compute them. An ad hoc approximate solution needs to be developed. And we'll use actually a property of stochastic system, which is that the probability of reaching some state is equal to the limit of the probability to reach some state in at most n step. So that we will use very often from now. So in fact, the probability of reaching a target is either you reach in one step or in two step or in three step, and so on and so forth. Which means that this equation holds actually. Okay, but how can we use this to have approximate algorithm for quantitative model checking? That's what I will explain now, or at least I will explain one solution for this. So first we define this bad guy. So it's a trap, it's a set of states from which we cannot reach the good state we are targeting. And then the approximation scheme, which we could call finite horizon approximation, is the following. In fact, we want to know whether we can reach, we want to compute what is the probability to reach the target in no more than one step. And then also to compute what is the probability to be blocked in this trap in no more than one step. And then there is something in the middle, which is we don't know yet what will happen there. But what we know for sure is that the probability we are targeting, we want to approximate, is in between this value, so the probability of reaching this guy, and one minus this value, because we are, if we go there, it's dead somehow. We can no more hope to reach a good guy. And we can proceed, we can unfold that way, and we can say, okay, that it can be that we don't reach it in one step, but in two steps. And this is exactly what represents P2, yes. And one minus P2, no, is the probability of reaching the trap here or the trap here. And we continue that way. We unfold up to infinity if we can. And we want to know whether at some point we converge. And what we can do with that value in case it converges. So we have examples where this, in fact, this unfolding on this finite horizon computation is not converging. This is something rather known, which is, for instance, this random walk. So the random walk we started at S1, and we can go with probability P to the right and with 1 minus P to the left, and there is this final state on the left. And we know that, in fact, you can check that the trap is empty, because it's always possible to go back to these good guys. Even if you are far away here, you can go back with some probability to this state here. So P and no is always equal to zero. And now we know that if the random walk is not balanced, which means that P is larger than 1/2, then the probability of going back to the origin, to this good guy, is actually smaller strictly than 1. This is a property of this kind of random walk, which means that actually P and yes is always smaller than 1 minus something, with something which is fixed. That means that the two sequences are not adjacent, and which means, if we go back here, that this approximation scheme is not convergent. So we can compute this, but it will never, in fact, if you want to stop when the two values are close enough, you will never terminate, you will never converge. And this is true, even if this property is true. So we know that at the limit, the probability of reaching the target is equal to this finite horizon approximation, but the approximation scheme that we had on the previous slide will not converge. So you will never know you are close enough to the real probability you are looking at. Okay? So don't interrupt me if there is something unclear, please. And in fact, there is a good property of DTMCs, which has been identified in 2007 by Parosh Abdullah, Benenda, and Mayer, which is that of decisiveness. On a Markov chain, is said decisive if it's true that for every state, from every state, you can either reach the good guy or the trap with probability 1. And that was not the case on the unbalanced random walk. But we have many examples of Markov chains which are decisive. The first class, which is rather obvious, is the one of finite Markov chains. If you have a finite Markov chain, it is a decisive Markov chain. It's easy to check. But you have other kinds of Markov chains that are also decisive, like probabilistic lossy channel systems. So you have Markov chains built on channel system where the communication is a bit weird, it's a bit lossy, so you can lose some information. Or for those who know, you have also probabilistic vector addition systems, so Petrinets. Or you have also a model that was not, noisy Turing machines, that was not something I knew before this article, but okay, this is also a model which is decisive. So the counterexample is the one I gave earlier, the unbalanced random walk is not decisive. And what is very nice when you have a decisive Markov chain is that the approximation scheme, which is very natural because you compute for every length the probability of reaching the good state in that length, or to never be able to reach again that good state in n step. Actually, if m is a decisive Markov chain, then the approximation scheme converges and is correct. It gives you at the end an epsilon approximation of the value you are targeting. And actually, it's even a characterization. Somehow, it does converge if and only if the Markov chain is decisive. So this is quite natural. Okay, so that's something due to these people quite some time ago now. And actually, what they did also is I think this article is very nice, but they did not only study reachability properties, but also some other properties like repeated reachability. They have another scheme, approximation scheme, which is also finite horizon property. So you can see it on the right here. And under the assumption, some decisiveness assumption, they show that this scheme is correct. It converges and it is correct with respect to repeated reachability. So here you want to reach that good guy infinitely often. I will not go into details of this precise scheme, but it can go beyond reachability properties. I want to mention this, even though I will not detail Müller properties, but if you take some omega regular properties, we can also do interesting things. Actually, it was done by Abdullah, Bertrand, Rabinowitz, and Schnebelen, focusing on this lossy channel system. But this scheme, what they propose actually go to decisive Markov chain. That's why I wanted to present it to you here. But it's based on something which is called an attractor. So in a Markov chain, an attractor is some set of states that you can reach from everywhere with probability one. A finite Markov chain has a finite attractor because you can just take the set of states of the Markov chain. It's not very interesting, but there are interesting properties if M is denumerable and if it admits a finite attractor, you can show that it's decisive. So that's a way to prove decisiveness of systems. And I didn't mention it here, but there are many systems that actually have finite attractors, like lossy channel system. So you have a finite set of states that you are sure to visit infinitely often with probability one. So if you take, for instance, this lossy channel system, you are almost surely to visit infinitely often a configuration where the channel is empty. This is a finite attractor, the configuration where channel is empty. And actually, using this, we can design algorithm to compute approximation of properties that are much more complex than reachability properties. So here I depicted something, but I will not go into details here. But actually, when you have a finite attractor, you can use the approximation scheme for reachability to compute probabilities of richer properties like Müller properties, omega regular properties. Okay, so why is that very useful for the more general real-time stochastic systems, which appear to be more complex because you have continuous time, continuous space, whatever? So actually, so this is the example we had before. And I would like first to show you how we can formalize this continuous time stochastic system. So in fact, a stochastic transition system is like for a Markov chain, so you have a set of states which form a measurable space. You need something to be measurable. And we have what we call a Markov kernel, which tells us from a state S how does it distribute in the future? So how in one step you can reach other parts of the systems. So if you take, for instance, so you start from S0, for instance, and you know that you have some distribution to reach that part of the system. And the kappa, which is called the kernel, tells you how is the probability distribution to reach the possible next state of the system. And you have that for every state. And using these kernels repeatedly, in fact, you can define probabilities of passes in such a system. So you cannot measure every single pass of the system, but you can measure large families of passes of the system. Okay. And you can define, so here you take, for instance, the integral over all possible initial states. So this is the yellow part here. So you have the integral on the yellow part here of how do you reach the in one step something else in the system. This is the green part here. And you integrate over all possible next state of the system and so on and so forth. And you define like this a probability over what we call cylinders, that is passes that go through A0, A1, etc., AN, and then they do whatever they want. This defines a probability measure on the set of infinite paths in the system. So some examples, because maybe it's a bit abstract, but we can recover discrete time Markov chains that way, taking as the set of states that we can measure, the subset of the set of states. And then the kernel is nothing else than the probability matrix, I would say, of the Markov chain. And then you have many models that I will illustrate right after. So maybe some of you know queuing system, which are we can define using continuous time Markov chain. So in fact, we have a countable number of discrete states. And we have events that can happen with some probability and with the probability over the delays. So lambda and nu here are parameters of some exponential distribution, saying that, for instance, from S1, the arrival time of something in the queuing system will be parameterized by lambda, and the fact that the task is handled will be parameterized by nu. And then if you are in S1, the two will compete and there will be some race between the events to know whether first S2 will happen or S0 will happen. And in fact, we can see this it's a bit technical to describe with mathematical formulas, but we can describe using a kernel, this kind of system. So we know that a race, so if we are in some state S, and if we want to know whether event E will happen, then the race will be, we know that it will be lambda E, which is the lambda which is there, divided by the sum of all possible events. So here it would be lambda divided by lambda plus nu. And then if you want to reach to the delay to be between T plus D1 and T plus D2, then you take the integral between D1 and D2 of this kind of exponential. This is, you apply this exponential distribution with this parameter, which is the race between the two. And then you have this GSMP that we saw with the two machines which can crash and you have to reboot. So here it's a bit more abstract with two events that can happen, E1 and E2. One is attached with some kind of probability distribution like this one, and the other one is an exponential like this one. And then the semantics is given as follows actually. So we sample the two events according to their distribution, and the first one which will occur will win the race somehow, and we'll either go to S1 or to S2, depending on the sample delay of the two of the two events. So this can be formalized also using a stochastic transition system and with some integral that we can define. So we can also, obviously, we can also see this as this general model of a stochastic transition system. Another one that I want to discuss, because I like this model very much. So maybe some of you or many of you know the model of time automata. And now if you take the model of time automata and you assign random delays, so you assume that delays are random, then this gives what we call stochastic time automata. So here is a time automaton. So you have clocks that evolve with time. And whenever x is less than one, the value of the clock is less than one, you can go to S1 and then to S2 if it's still the case, or you go to S3. And now, so this is standard time automata with a various number of clocks. And actually, we attach delay, we attach distribution to delays to know how time evolves. So it's more like, for instance, from S0, it's more likely for the next time to be 1/2 than to be close to 1 or close to 0. And here, in S1, it's more likely for the delay in S1 to be close to 0 than to be quite large. Okay, and actually we can also formalize this using these kernels on this stochastic transition system. But the idea is really more simple than the formula in the sense that we sample the next delay. Usually in time automata, you select the delay in a non-deterministic manner. So you say, okay, I missed S0, next will have to be more, smaller than one, and I can either take this or this. And in time automata, we select the delay using a distribution on the next transition using a distribution that needs to be defined in the model. This is really pure stochastic model, so there is no non-determinism. And now, if we want to apply the approach, the very nice approach of Abdullah and others using decisiveness, first, we need to redefine what is a trap. Because the trap was a graph property earlier, and now it needs to be a bit refined in the sense that single pass going to a happy state is not enough. We will be in a trap if it's the case that the probability is zero, actually. There is a mistake here. So this is equal to zero. Almost surely I will avoid this state, then I'm in the trap.
Lucretia, can I stop you? There is a question in the chat. So Manuel is asking, what is the connection between GSMP and labeled Markov processes?
I wonder whether in labeled Markov processes you have non-determinism. I think there is non-determinism in the action. And here we don't have non-determinism. It's purely stochastic. Does that make sense?
Yeah, thank you.
So now we can adapt the definition of decisiveness by saying that earlier it was for every state I should have this nice almost sure property. Now I want it to be true from every distribution. So I have my space, which is continuous. I put any kind of distribution on this space, and I want to be almost sure to reach either this yellow guy or the trap. Oops. And now I ask the question, how should I approximate probabilities? How should I design algorithms for approximating probabilities of some reachability property? So in fact, the scheme is the same. Symbolically, it looks very similar. In fact, we can prove the same that using this new definition of decisiveness, then we can have a converging approximation scheme, which is correct. So it's really the same as for denumerable Markov chains. And actually, we can apply this scheme to classes of system when we can first compute the trap, which is something that needs to be done at first. And then we need to be able to compute PN yes and PN no. So we need to have some computability properties in the measurable state space of the system. So probability distribution needs to be also effective in the sense that we need to be able to compute probabilities of such sequences of states. This is something that will not, some people work on this. This is really a tough job to find a probability distribution that we can manipulate very well. But in fact, what we say here is that under computability assumption, the approximation scheme will be correct, converging and correct for classes of systems which are decisive. And all other approximation schemes that I already mentioned also apply in this setting. Okay, so are we done? Of course not, we are not done because it's hard to show decisiveness in general. So what we decided to do is actually to design methods to avoid proving decisiveness, which is too hard, and to identify for free subclasses of systems which are decisive. So somehow I would like to be able to tell you, take this time, if you can model your system in this class of models, then approximation scheme will be correct and use it. In fact, for those familiar with real-time system, there is a tool which we like to use. It's a one of abstraction for time automata. For instance, you have this region automata. So in fact, we'll formalize this and make it a bit more abstract for a more general system. But somehow we'll be able to, in fact, we'll do something like the region abstraction. If you don't know it, it's not a problem. But for those who know, maybe it's a good reference to you. Okay, so I take two transition systems and a measurable function between the two. So it's better with a picture. So you take a system and you take some system which look a bit simpler. And somehow you gather states which, so in all the blue states you put, you assume it's now the abstraction alpha maps all these states to this one. And what you assume is that something which is quite natural, if it's possible for you to go with some probability to some blue state, to some pink state, then there should be a positive probability here as well. So we say that T2, this one, is an alpha abstraction whenever P1 positive is equivalent to P2 positive. This is natural to have this kind of thing. And now we'll say that the abstraction is sound whenever it preserves quite well reachability properties. So whenever it's the case that you can reach from some state, it's not precise here, but from some state, you can reach the green with probability one, and it should be the case in the original system, so in the concrete system. And if you have this, in fact, you have very nice properties that are satisfied, which is that if you have a sound abstraction, if T2 is decisive, then T1 is decisive. So if T2 is simple, so for instance, if T2 is a finite Markov chain, it is decisive in all cases. So it means that T1 is decisive with respect to some alpha complete thing, but we have good properties of decisiveness in the original system. And I told you also about this nice object, which is called attractor. If you have an attractor in T2, then it will also be an attractor in T1, if you are in a context of a sound abstraction. So how can we use this kind of result? So you take your model, your current model, which is quite complex with these integrals in all the dimensions. So you have T1, and you have T2, which is something that is a bit more simple, like a countable or finite Markov chains with a finite attractor. So as I said, for instance, lossy channel system have a finite attractor. Finite Markov chains have finite attractors. And now if we assume that T2 is a sound abstraction, then actually you can prove that you can model check, almost sure model checking can be done in T1 or in T2, it's equivalent. And T2 is simple, so you can do it on T2, it's better. And now you can also do something quite interesting is that if you want to compute the probability, so now it's quantitative, of some property, forget about Muller, but of some property in your complex system, if you can reduce it to the computation of reachability in your original system using some components given by your abstraction. So you have this kind of formula, which is that the probability of some property is equal to the probability of some reachability property, something that you can actually compute, approximate. Okay, so why is that? I want to point to you also something specific to real-time system, because what I said so far applies to continuous space stochastic system. No matter whether there is time involved or not, it applies to continuous space system. Now you have a particular component that is time. So this is why my state space is decomposed into one real geometrical space, I would say, on some time. And if you assume that the time elapses almost surely, so for those who know, it means that almost surely you are non-zero. Then, in fact, we have very natural attractors, which are all the sets that are after some delay. So if you fix some delta, the fact that the time is larger than delta form an attractor. And why is that interesting? It's interesting because we can then prove that T is decisive with respect to everything which is time-bounded. And in particular, one gets immediately schemes which allow to approximate the probability of all time-bounded properties in such a system. So if you want to know whether you can reach some goal in no more than 5 time units, for instance, then you can approximate it using our scheme we showed earlier. Because we have some decisiveness, some attractor that we can point to. So this is something I think is rather interesting. On what kind of application? So it's a theoretical application, but in fact, it applies to quite some classes of systems. So I show you stochastic time automata. And in fact, we can use abstractions. And you can use the Markov chain built on region automaton, the standard region automaton. And in fact, under several assumptions, so either you take single clock automata, or you take what we have called reactive time automata, that is time automata which are complete with respect to delays. That means that you can wait. In every state, you have a possibility to delay and do something later. Then in that case, we can finite attractors in the region automaton, which is that we can have, approximated algorithm for many properties in these classes of system. So in fact, with that approach, we recovered all decidability and approximability results that were known before on that kind of model. I have counterexample of time automata which do not belong, which are not decisive, where there is no attractor, which is a bit, it was an example that were a bit annoying us before. So if you take this actually, you see something, it's that you start from S0 with Y between 0 and 1. And then if you leave that before 1, then you can go along this loop. And if you leave that between 1 and 2, then you go along this loop. And you go back to S0. And you realize if you do that in a non-deterministic way, you will start with Y equal to Y0. Next time it will be Y1 larger than Y0. Next time will be Y2 larger. And you have a limit, which is new, which is some value smaller than 1. And then if you analyze this, you realize that the probability of taking this edge would be something like Y1 minus Yn over 2 minus Yn, and the probability of going on the top will be that value. And at the limit, it's something like this. It just you go to the limit. And you realize that this can be very close to zero. And due to that, what does that mean? That means that the probability of taking this, the more you will loop in this automaton, the more will be the probability small to take this stage. So after many loops in this automaton, the probability to take the green edge will be much smaller than the probability to take this orange edge, which means that we will be missing some fairness in the behavior of the system. And actually, we can prove that the system is not fair, which means that the region automaton, which will be fair, which will be fair because it will be finite state, will not help us analyzing this system. So actually, one can show that this automaton is not decisive, and that the region automaton does not correctly evaluate the probability of reaching the target. Because if you build the region automaton of this, the probability to reach the target is one. But if you, in this automaton with the real value of the clock, it will be smaller than one. But in fact, the automaton, this automaton does not fit into this class of system. So this is a counter example, but it's okay. It's not a, it does not fit into the class. Okay, on, I want to mention also generalized semi-Markov processes. In fact, we can show also using some region of abstraction, which is a bit refined, but that we have an abstraction which is sound, like for time automata, so that GSMPs are decisive when events have no fixed delay. So you cannot say this event will happen in one time unit, for sure. You have to have intervals of delays. So this is what we call GSMP with no fixed delay. And under that assumption, we can model check GSMPs using our approach. And actually, this is something interesting because this, in a paper by Brasdil, Krautschal, Kretinsky, React in 2011, they showed that the original abstraction was not correct with respect to GSMP when there were fixed delay events. So in fact, we recover their warning somehow that with fixed delay events, we should be very careful. Yes, actually, because we are not decisive. And that was the example they got for fixed delay events. I will not enter into detail, but here they have events that have fixed lengths. So this one, P and C, I think, have delay one. And then I would like to mention Petri nets. So stochastic Petri nets, when you assign probability distribution to delays of enabled transitions, we can restrict a bit our framework using bounded Petri nets, and we can make the assumption that they are Markov regenerative. So that means that we have regeneration points that are encountered almost surely, infinitely often. This is what we call regenerative stochastic Petri nets. We call, not me, but it was studied earlier. And this is an assumption on stochastic Petri nets. And actually, we can show that regeneration points form a finite attractor, which means that the standard state class graph of Petri net is a sound abstraction, and which implies that regenerative Petri nets are decisive, which implies that we can analyze these regenerative Petri nets. We can have approximation algorithm as we described earlier. Of course, provided numerical computation can be done, that we didn't study at all. And this is really a topic that people were looking at when they defined the regenerative Petri net. But okay, the reason why it's possible to have approximation algorithm is because they have a finite attractor. And I wanted to conclude and to give a word about simulation. So what we did here is a quite abstract and generic approach to approximate analysis of stochastic processes with an arbitrary state space, I would say, and which is based on finite horizon computations. And we made a hypothesis for that. So we need to have attractors or to be decisive, to be able to prove decisiveness. But under those assumptions, we can provide guarantees on the approximation that we compute. It requires numerical computability properties that we did not study here, but the approach applies to classes of real-time stochastic systems like the one I mentioned, stochastic time automata, GSMPs, Petrinets. And the decisiveness property is in the core of the approach. It's not so easy to manipulate. It's a property which is not so easy to manipulate. That's why tools like attractors and abstraction are actually very helpful when we try to find classes of systems to which this approach applies. And why do I want to now speak about statistical model checking? So maybe quick is only one slide, so it will be quick. So we want to do Monte Carlo simulation. So we want to sample a large number of realization of some random variable and to compute the mean. And we know that under assumption, this is a good estimator of the expectation of X, the random variable, with some guarantees which are given, for instance, as confidence intervals. Now, in our case, so we have systems where we have executions. So a realization will be an execution, which is supposed to be infinite. On X, the variable X evaluates the property over execution. So for instance, it evaluates to 1 if the property is satisfied, or to 0 if it's not. If it's some quantitative property, it may have some value. This is also possible. And in fact, if we look at papers on statistical model checking, so maybe it's quite old, but we looked at this. In fact, in a paper by Younes and Simmons, they explain that everything works fine with time-bounded properties. They show that finite executions are sufficient. And if you recall, I also told you that for time-bounded properties, we can show decisiveness. So that's also a reason why it's possible to do time-bounded properties here. And for time-unbounded properties, they say that it requires some attention because we need first to be able to compute something, which happens to be the trap prior to simulations. And what they show is that the execution will almost surely be finite and in either the good state or in the trap. This really coincides with decisiveness, where almost surely we end up in one of the two. And what they say at the end is that this is applicable to finite Markov chains only. And what I would like to point here is that actually it applies to any decisive Markov chains, and not only to finite Markov chains, because the only assumption is that actually the decisiveness property is satisfied. Okay, that's all. So.
Thank you, Patricia. This was a very nice broad overview of the subject. Do we have any questions? So feel free to unmute yourself and ask, or raise your hand, whatever is easier for you. So in the meantime, I will ask if you have, if there are some type of results of the type when the distribution, when one of the states distributes in this fashion, then I can the approximation happens. Or if all states, if the distribution of all states are of this type, then is there some kind of results that follow and such a statement?
In fact, yes, because, for instance, it depends on the models, of course, but often if you have a memoryless distribution over delays, so exponential distribution, which are the only memoryless distribution over delays, then it will happen that you are in this case, so you are reactive. For instance, for time automata, you will always be also you will not have fixed delay. So for generalized semi-Markov processes, you will also, well, actually it will be Markov processes in this case. So that maybe that's why. Now, if you have in general, I would say no, you cannot assume, for instance, if you take the random walk, but which is unbalanced, and you make it continuous in the sense that you affect you assign a probability to delays, but with a much larger probability to go to the right than to the left, then it will be unbalanced, so it will not work for sure. So I think it's not possible to have a property like use this distribution over delays and you will be on the safe side. I think this will not work. For some classes, yes, like time automata, like Petrinets actually, if you have only exponent, exponential distribution, you will be regenerative. So it will also be working for Petrinets, yes, but not in general because of the random walk.
Okay. So let me just see that I haven't missed any question in the audience or in the chat. Okay, so in the meantime, I have another question. So is there some sort of abstraction that as a rule of thumb works when you try to infer about the abstract system?
I would say not in general, but somehow if you take often when we have a stochastic system, first you have underlying a non-deterministic system. So, and often, well, you can have abstraction at that level, like region automaton. Then first try this abstraction. For GSMP, it's not sufficient to do that. You need to refine it a bit. But I would say if you have an abstraction that works fine for a non-deterministic system, so if you can find finite abstraction for the non-deterministic underlying system, then try it. Try to see if it's decisive or not when you have probabilities. Mm-hmm. And if yes, yes, this is good, or sometimes you have to refine, or sometimes it will not work. For STA, this one, for instance, if you take any refined region automaton, it will not be correct. In fact, we can show that this example, there is no, it's not decisive, which means that there is no decisive sound abstraction. Otherwise, this one would be decisive. So, yeah. So first try what happens for the non-deterministic and then be careful.
I see. Okay, so thank you very much. It seems that we are running out of time. So if other people have questions that you didn't get to ask, please use the... So there is just one question from Manuela. Do you want to speak up or...
Is the time always discrete? No, the time is continuous. In the first part, it was discrete. So the time and the space was discrete. But here, the time is really continuous.
So apologies for other people who might have questions. So please, you can use the comments feature on the website or just write Patricia. So thank you, Patricia, very much. And we will now take a 10-minute break and continue with the contributed paper session.
Okay, bye-bye.